When we remember a time, we remember moments. A kaleidoscope of the sights, the sounds, the emotions that remind us of the way we were. Our world. It's about time. Tonight, Up Against the Wall, August, October, 1961. Here are Linda Ellerbee and Ray Gandolf.
For the next hour, think of your television set as a time machine.
We're going to a troubled time tonight, but a time when hope was more than a four-letter word.
Welcome to Our World. It is 1961, late summer, early fall. Some days we seem not so much to greet the dawn as to confront it. But then confrontation is in the air. And in Berlin, Southeast Asia, the South, space, the baseball park, and on TV. Someone is pushing and someone else is equally determined not to be pushed. Most of all, determined not to be pushed up against the wall. The wall. Sometimes they call it the new frontier.
In the summer of 61, the Soviet Union seemed to be flexing its muscles. Nikita Khrushchev wanted to resume nuclear testing, and he wanted to get the Allies out of Berlin. And he thought that President Kennedy, who had stubbed his toe so painfully at the Bay of Pigs, would be a soft touch. Before we begin with the dramatic events of August, September, and October, let's back up for a moment to June of 1961 and the summit meeting in Vienna. Khrushchev all but put a bear hug on Kennedy and laid it on the line.
At that meeting, Chairman Khrushchev tried to intimidate the new young president of the United States with an ultimatum on Berlin.
Secretary of State Dean Rusk was there.
He said that in a certain number of months, we're going to make an agreement with the East Germans that the excess rights will be a matter for the East Germans, that if you in the West try to interfere with these East German decisions, there will be war. And at one point, Mr. Kennedy had to look him straight in the eye and say, well, then, Mr. Chairman, there will be war.
Well, there was no war, of course. Khrushchev did not make his separate peace with East Germany. But in August, when we pick up our story, he did order or allow the East Germans to put Berliners, literally, up against the wall.
More tension, more refugees. In the first 2 weeks of August, 16,000 people arrive in West Berlin. They all want asylum. Walt Rostow is the deputy director of the National Security Council.
People just began to pour out of East Germany, through East Berlin to West Berlin. And it was a flow of the ablest people and technicians and all the rest of it. It couldn't go on. And Kennedy thought it through. And he suddenly said, you know, East Germany is bleeding to death, and Khrushchev can't afford that. He's going to have to do something, possibly a wall.
Saturday, August 12th, a record 3,300 refugees register at the Marienfeld refugee camp in West Berlin. Daniel Shore is a correspondent for CBS News.
I spent all day with camera crew at Marienfelde that day interviewing the refugees, all of whom said they thought they might be the last people to leave. They seemed to know that something would happen within the next 24 hours.
In West Berlin, it's an ordinary Saturday night. But not in East Berlin. And not for East German border guard Rudi Turow.
At midnight, August 12th, we had a combat alert. We were told that everything around West Berlin would be closed off. We were told that if there was a conflict, we would ride into battle on Russian tanks.
August 13th, Sunday, 2 a.m. East German soldiers show up at the border, and under man-made lights, they begin to build a man-made barricade. Daniel Shore is an eyewitness.
It's half light, and it's hard to discern what's happening. What do they got there? It looks like bales of barbed wire. And what are those funny concrete things that they've got? And why do they got those crowbars? They're digging up cobblestones. Why do they want to do that? Then we began to grasp the full dimension of what was happening. They were going to take over and seal that border.
Peter Diemel is a cameraman for NBC.
They were stringing their barbed wire, and we were very close to them. I was could touch them, and we even spoke. And they were making jokes. I said, well, what's this? And they said, oh, well, we are just doing this so you can't go over our green here, something like that. It was just a very, very relaxed thing. But a few hours later, it became very, very tense.
Crowds gather on the west side to taunt the East German soldiers as they build the wall. Some people, finding themselves being sealed off from family, friends, jobs, begged the East German soldiers to let them through. East German soldiers use water cannon and tear gas on West German crowds. West German police finally are called out to prevent battle between civilians on the west and the soldiers on the east. But where are the Allied armies that occupy West Berlin? Where are the good guys, and why aren't they doing something?
It was a tense situation. We didn't know what would happen, but we all thought we would have to fight, because no one believed that the Western Allies would allow us to block off all of East Berlin.
Berlin waits because Washington has already made up its mind. Nothing will be done. Not to ensure Berlin won't become a divided city, nor to protect anyone living in the East. President Kennedy has guaranteed freedom, but he meant freedom for those living in the West. We would not fight the wall.
If you know that at the end of the road, the West is not going to fight a war in order to knock the wall down in Berlin, then you better not start down that trail.
So the wall would stand, and for East Germans who wanted out, it was every man for himself. Kurt Wiesmach, a steelworker, wanted out. He and his wife made their way to the Teltow Canal on the border of the American sector.
We didn't see any guards here, so we decided to swim. First, I helped my wife across, and then I went back to get our clothes. When I was swimming back to the west, my wife called to me, "Watch it, Kurt. Some of them are coming. They could have shot us, but they didn't."
In the early days of the wall, before the border was sealed tight, escape was impromptu and dangerous.
We came here to film border guards setting up. And then we saw that over in East Berlin, there were some young people. It looked like they wanted to come over. And after a few minutes went by, they really started to run. And one girl hit very hard with her face. She really hit the barbed wire and fall down, and blood was over her face. But she was saved by some West Berliners.
Two American students from California, Victor Pankey and Gil Ferry, tried to help an East German woman escape. They brought their car to East Berlin. Victor Pankey tells what happened.
We went out into a darkened street an area that she felt was fairly safe. And she got in, since she appeared to be relatively comfortable, why we decided that we would give it a try. And so from that point, why we went directly to the Checkpoint Charlie crossing. And then they immediately asked to see what's in the car. They asked us to open the hood. We opened the hood, and there she was.
The two young men were arrested. After a month, they were tried and sentenced to 2 years in prison. They don't know what happened to the woman. Konrad Schumann was an East German soldier. He was supposed to help close the border, but he saw his chance for freedom, and he jumped at it, and he made it. The street where Schumann escaped, Bernauer Straße, presented many opportunities.
Bernauer Straße was a normal street in West Berlin, but the East Berlin side, the front of the houses, was actually the border. So people living in the houses, in their houses, were in East Berlin. Looking out of the window, they had the head in West Berlin already.
And when you jump out of a window, as soon as you reach the sidewalk, you are in West Berlin. That became an intolerable situation for these German popos, who after a while forced people to put barriers on their own windows to keep them from escaping.
Willy Finder, his wife and five-year-old son, lived at number 7 Bernauer Strasse on the fifth floor.
I got a call at work, my wife telling me to come home. When I got there, she was already in the window. On the west side, the fire department came and opened up the fire net. They were yelling, jump, jump, and I told my wife to jump. She started to cry and wanted to come back inside. But the East German police were already banging on our door. I said, there is no return now, and I ran to the window and pushed her. Some East German soldiers shot at her while she was falling. The West Berlin police fired some warning shots, and they stopped. Next, I dropped my son, and then I climbed out. The soldiers threw tear gas at the firemen, and some of them lost their grip. I hit the sidewalk and injured my spine. When they carried me to the ambulance, I asked where my wife was. No one knew.
He found her. She was badly hurt, but she recovered. Come back for a young Yankee taking aim at the ancient babe. And for all those young babes, babes in arms, who seemed to be taking over America.
Don't let it be forgotten that once there was a spot for one brief shining moment.
That was known as Camelot. Camelot, the ideal kingdom of Arthur, the idealistic king. Camelot was a legend. And in 1961, Camelot was a Broadway hit musical and a metaphor. Except we had no king. We had instead a belief in the idealism of John Kennedy, who had his own dragons. The Berlin Wall, the space race, the South. Could he pull it off and save the land? And meanwhile, what do the simple folk do? Well, there's always baseball.
Who put the bomb in the bomb, the bomb, the bomb? Who put the ram in the ram, a ram, a ding dong? Who put the bomb?
In 1961, the backs up against the wall in baseball belonged to outfielders.
Was that man? I'd like to shake his hand.
The guys hitting most of the home runs were Roger Maris and Mickey Mantle, both making a run at Babe Ruth's record of 60 homers in one season. Their effort was tracked every day, pitch by pitch.
Well, they started writing about it probably about the middle of the season. You could see that both of us was going to have a lot of home runs.
Mel Allen was a Yankee broadcaster.
There was a play on Broadway that year called Dial M for Murder. And being a broadcaster, you know, and full of corn every now and then, what better than to say, here they come, the M&M boys, Dial M for Murder.
It wasn't just Mantle and Maris. Baseballs seemed to be flying out of the parks in carload lots that summer. So the New York Times commissioned some engineers to see if there was more rabbit in the ball. Baseballs were fired from a small cannon and compared with those of yesteryear. They were dissected to see what was inside. They looked and acted pretty much like the old balls. But one important thing was different. 1961, the first year of expansion in the American League, was the first year of the 162-game schedule instead of 154. Many believed that a record set in those 8 extra games would be tainted. That sour note just added to the pressure that was building on the two Yankee sluggers. For the veteran Mantle, who had once hit 52 home runs in a season, being under a microscope was old hat. For the introverted, less popular Maris, it was all new.
The pressure started building the last 2 months. I mean, everywhere we would go, you know, people was there with cameras, so it got pretty hectic.
After 54 home runs, Mantle was injured and out of the race. Now the pressure was all on Maris.
I knew it was going to get pretty bad on him, and in fact, it got so bad there the last month that his nerves were so bad that he was losing, like, patches of his hair.
Maris hit his 59th home run in his 154th game. Now he's in the extended season. And with 4 games to go, he had still not tied Babe Ruth.
All right, 2 balls, 2 strikes. And it's a ball hit deep. It's in there, upstairs.
Going into the last game of the season, Maris had tied, but not broken, Babe Ruth's record.
It wound up with Roger Maris being under the greatest pressure he'd ever been in his life.
Here's the windup. Fastball hit deep to right. This could be it. Way back there. Holy cow, he did it.
Just the sound, the crack of the bat, and you knew that ball was gone. We all wanted to jump up and scream.
I get goosebumps watching him hit his last home run. He just ran right around the bases just like he always did. Ran into the dugout, and he was embarrassed to come back out and take his hat off and say thank you.
And they want Maris to come out and take another bow. He does. Holy cow, what a shot.
Roger Maris broke one big record that summer. Parents were breaking records every day.
You know you must have been a beautiful baby.
The baby boom had crested, and kids were competing before they could walk.
The judge's eyes as they handed you the prize. I bet you took the cutest bow.
Swimming, crawling, or walking, there are 40 million Americans less than 10 years old.
Well, the birth rate was really exploding at that time.
Mel Helitzer was in the toy business.
We had about 4 million births in the country each year, which comes down to about some woman was giving birth every 8.5 seconds. And the joke was we had to get hold of that woman and stop her.
President Kennedy led the way. For the first time since Theodore Roosevelt, there were little kids in the White House.
And in practically no time, cares of state are given over for the cares of keeping up with an energetic four-year-old in overalls.
We coddled our children, catered to them, and recorded their every move in Kodachrome. And above all, we wanted our kids to be smart.
Meet Susie Smart, she is so bright. On her blackboard, you can write
2 + 2 = 4.
You can spell!
Twinkle, twinkle.
A good toy should be more than fun.
AquaJet, the first of its kind anywhere. A jet airplane that really flies by water pressure from your garden hose. The same principle that makes the real jets fly. Pilot's crew, we will...
A good toy had educational value. We were concerned about their future education. Were they going to be the great scientists and the great writers and the designers?
Jimmy Jet! The amazing new toy.
Toy designers have found an amazing new way to sell directly to children, television.
Makes you feel you can fly.
In 1961, the average child watches TV about 4 hours a day. And what he watches doesn't seem likely to make him any smarter. Take this primetime show on CBS.
Now, while I'm looking right at you, say something.
Oh, no. Round call.
Or this primetime show on ABC. The chairman of the FCC decides he's had enough of the networks lowering their aim, and in September he makes a speech attacking the shows the networks offer. Newton Minow, the chairman of the FCC.
They are dull, they are gray, they are insipid. They are like dishwater, just as tasteless and just as nourishing.
Well, I thought that television is the greatest teacher of all time. So there had to be a responsibility on the part of the adults who were creating the programs to serve children in a responsible way.
Newton Minow's idea of good TV for kids is what's known as educational TV, like Mr. Wizard.
That's what all the kids in the neighborhood call him, because he shows them the magic and mystery of science in everyday living.
For the defense, Mike Dann, head of programming at CBS.
It would be pretty hard to have convinced Newt Minow that even Bugs Bunny or the Three Stooges or Car 54 or Father Knows Best or the Flintstones had any redeeming characteristics. We, of course, took a different point of view.
Well, after all, I am a graduate of MIT, the Muth Institute of Toe Dancing.
I would say that Newton Minow's speech was entirely ignored. Nothing was done. Absolutely nothing was done.
to maintain a flexibility of response.
And meanwhile, there is more on television to worry about, like reality.
We will use nuclear weapons whenever we feel it necessary to protect our vital interests. Our nuclear.
The scariest program on television, the network news.
Fallout levels from Russia's nuclear explosion.
On September 1st, the Soviets start testing atomic bombs in the atmosphere. Because of Berlin, they say. The U.S. resumes underground tests. Because of the Soviets, we say. And we trace fallout patterns and worry and think about digging bomb shelters. For the children's sake. Down in Rome, Georgia, Cherry Birdsong already has three children and a shelter.
Ms. Birdsong, would you tell us why you're going into the shelter for a week?
Yes, of course, I hope this country is never attacked, but in the event that it is, I would like to be able to know how to live in the shelter.
It seemed like every paper we picked up almost, they were asking people to build fallout shelters and be prepared. We decided it was of no use unless we really knew how to live in it. I was the logical one to go down and really see how it would be.
I'm alone because I love you. Love you with all.
It was a comfort to know that it was there and that I had done that and that I knew a little bit about living down there and it could be done.
Where have all the flowers gone? Long time passing.
A new political movement takes shape under the threat of a mushroom-shaped cloud. Man the bomb, it says, and sings. And a new musical movement takes shape behind the politics. It includes this struggling group, Peter, Paul, and Mary.
When will they ever learn?
It was time to say we don't want war, but we weren't referring to a specific war. We were referring to the possibility of nuclear war and to the reality of underground bomb shelters being built all over the country.
And where have all the men gone? Long time passing. Where have all the young men gone? Long time ago. Where have all the young men gone? Gone for soldiers and
in September of 1961, a young singer turned up at Folk City in New York and got rave reviews, noting that the 20-year-old Bob Dylan looked like a cross between a choir boy and a beatnik. The Times critic said that Dylan's music had the mark of originality and inspiration. Come back to our world and to some Americans up against the wall in Berlin in Southeast Asia. They were young, too.
The kids in Bristol are sharp and physical when they do the Bristol stop.
Our world will be right back.
When they do the Bristol stop.
Welcome back to Our World. It's 1961 and it's that time of year when summer turns to fall, or as sometimes happens, when summer confronts fall. Change is rarely a graceful operation. For instance, we face a crisis in Berlin, another in the South, another in Southeast Asia, not to mention the bomb, the bomb. Still, our president, John Kennedy, points out that when written in Chinese, the word crisis is composed of two characters,
One represents danger, the other represents opportunity.
Two continents were aglow with brush fires that season. In Vietnam, the Viet Cong guerrillas were winning hearts and minds and villages from the Diem government. The United Nations had troops in the Congo fighting for the central government against the province of Katanga. White mercenaries fought for Katanga. Dag Hammarskjöld, the UN Secretary General, was killed in a plane crash in September on a mission to mediate that crisis. And then, of course, there was that wall we were up against in Berlin.
The wall is finished. The crisis is not. As summer ends and fall begins, the Soviet pressure on the Allied garrison increases. American troops in Germany are training for combat. In America, Kennedy asks for and gets a huge increase in the military budget. In August, he begins to call up the reserves. More than 200,000 reservists are ordered to report for combat training. Among the 76,000 called up for a year's active duty, Company B of the 101st Signal Battalion, Yonkers, New York.
You know, the Eisenhower years were over. I saw JFK coming in, new kid on the block in the international affairs, and he was being tested.
At Fort Devens, Massachusetts, they trained to fight in Europe and record it on film. There's even a song written about the call-up.
But I'll go for God, country, and my baby. You know I have to go, and dear, I'll miss you so.
We didn't know where we were going and how long we were going to be away. So we got up there and then we found out that we might be shipped overseas. We had the training, we had good officers that trained us well, and we were ready to go. And if we had to go fight, we'd go fight.
Well, we knew we were going. There was a mission for us, and our equipment was in Germany, and we had 8 weeks, what they called intensified training at that time, to get them ready to go to Germany, and they were ready.
And when the Soviets begin to restrict Western access to East Berlin, it looks as if there might be a war to go to. On October 27th, American tanks move into place at Checkpoint Charlie, one of the crossings. For one day, U.S. and Soviet tanks face off. It is close, real close. But on the 28th, the tanks are withdrawn. That is one wall we've come up against, but not gone through. There are other walls. The Soviets support what they call wars of liberation. And all around the world, these wars pit American interests against Soviet interests. This is true in the Congo, in Laos, and in Vietnam. Walt Rostow helped Kennedy figure out what to do.
The Soviets felt this was an interval of historical opportunity. And they pushed very hard where opportunity offered.
In Southeast Asia, there's plenty of opportunity. We send advisors, money, and guns to Laos and Vietnam. We are not, we say, propping up dictators. We are, we say, fighting the expansion of communism. By October, the war isn't going well for South Vietnam, our side. Kennedy asked his military advisor, General Maxwell Taylor and Walt Rostow, to go to Vietnam, to look hard, and then give him some advice.
General Taylor was the head of the mission. I was his deputy. And we had a team, I forget how many, maybe 8, 10 men from different agencies. So when they hit the ground in Saigon, they were each, you know, fanned out to write their reports. And some were political, some were economic, some were military, and so on.
In public, Kennedy has declared the war to be the business of the Vietnamese. In private, Kennedy tells his team the defense of South Vietnam is vital to the U.S.
We didn't go out until the president had decided that he was not going to see that area lost. From our point of view, it was an implementation mission, not a policy mission.
But the mission returns to offer new policy. They tell Kennedy he should send American combat troops to Vietnam. It is the first time this is suggested. Pierre Salinger, the president's press secretary.
But we did not send combat troops. And we never sent combat troops during the time that President Kennedy was in office. Why? Because President Kennedy believed that the United States had a responsibility to help South Vietnam, but not a responsibility to take up the warfare on behalf of South Vietnam.
Some young Americans ventured far from home that summer, armed only with knowledge and a sense of responsibility. They were called the Peace Corps. 23-year-old Dennis Galvin was one of the first to volunteer.
And I think that we can help. I think the Peace Corps can help in these countries.
My family was shocked. South Boston is a place where people are hardworking and God-fearing, and they don't worry about what happens in East Africa very much.
Throughout the summer, the volunteers trained for their new jobs. On August 28th, President Kennedy addressed the first group of 74 volunteers.
If you do well, then the Peace Corps will be developed, and more Americans will go abroad. And we'll find a greater and greater response to this idea of serving our country. Thank you.
I remember saying to Kennedy, I now know more about Tanganyika than I know about South Boston. And he laughed. I moved on. But that was a very important moment for me.
As that first group prepared to leave for Ghana and Tanganyika, Sergeant Shriver, the director of the Peace Corps, was worried.
For that whole project to be a failure would give Kennedy's political opponents an opportunity to say, ha, see what we told you? He's too young to have been elected president. He's too inexperienced to have been elected president. So I was worried, yes, I was worried. I wanted it to be a success, and it had to be an instantaneous success.
And that took more than knowledge and goodwill. It needed strong bodies. The volunteers were sent to survival school. Reverend William Sloan Coffin ran it like a boot camp.
Nobody likes to do it. I hate it myself, you know, but if you accept it and you do it, why, you know, there's value in it.
We had a rope course, and we had all kinds of exercises. But all designed to make people feel they couldn't do that. And then they did do it. And I would kind of make the point, you know, you did it physically, you're expected to do it intellectually, morally, spiritually. That's why you're in the Peace Corps.
Africa is beautiful, but many of its people spend their lives up against the walls of poverty and ignorance. The Peace Corps attacked those walls. Dennis Galvin did it by building roads in northern Tanganyika.
Putting 21 surveyors into that country probably tripled, or at least doubled, the number of surveyors. Even in that very simple way of increasing the technical capacities of the country, that was an important contribution.
The Peace Corps was an instant success. Sergeant Shriver needn't have worried, and the volunteers had learned as much as they taught.
I mapped roads all over the province. We did a couple of jobs in town, built a couple of bridges. I built a water supply over there, and I've worked on a lot of jobs and a lot of places since then, but I'm as proud of that water supply as any job I've ever done anywhere.
There was this tiny hypocrisy. We sent people out to teach the American way, but we sent some of them to countries whose representatives to the United Nations weren't allowed to eat in American restaurants, not white American restaurants. This, too, was the American way. Come back. Bring your ticket for the Freedom Ride. A bus tour to and through the wall separating white from black.
Our world will continue in a moment with Up Against the Wall, August, October, 1961.
Welcome back to the late summer of 1961. In most of the South that season, this is what a black person found in a bus station. Despite the law of the land, old customs, and in some cases state law, prevailed. Enter the Freedom Riders, seven blacks and six whites who that spring challenged segregated facilities in several southern states. Mostly they were insulted or ignored, but in Alabama they ran into trouble and were beaten by mobs. By the time they got to Mississippi, the original Freedom Riders had retired from the field. But hundreds of people, mostly young people, were taking their place, and in September would win their point. Now, to illustrate that victory, we're going to back up our time frame a little, the late spring of 1961, a year, incidentally, when some blacks seemed to be doing just fine.
Jim Crow does at least seem mortally wounded. In many cities, integration has been peaceful, as local police and local people uphold the law of the land. And the Marvelettes have the number one song on the mostly white pop charts. Please, Mr. Postman is the biggest hit so far for a new company called Motown. Black comedians like Dick Gregory make black jokes for white audiences.
I mean, now don't get me wrong, I wouldn't mind paying my income tax if I knew it was going to a friendly country.
It may be a friendly country, but to blacks, it's a damn slow one.
The white man, time is running out on him. Just like his eyes. He's got to go.
That September, ABC broadcast a documentary. It tells the black point of view. It's about impatience. It is not popular in some parts of the South. They boycott the sponsor, Bell and Howell. Louisiana prohibits its schools from buying their products. Last spring, a group of activists from CORE, the Congress of Racial Equality, began to force a confrontation between the federal and state law. They called it a freedom ride. They call themselves freedom riders. James Farmer was the head of CORE.
We began the Freedom Rides as an attempt to break down one part of that segregated pattern. That part was segregation in interstate travel. We felt we were not practicing civil disobedience because the federal law was on our side.
The federal courts had ruled segregation was illegal in interstate travel, but they had not really challenged the state laws about it. Attorney General Robert Kennedy had asked the Interstate Commerce Commission for a ruling. Mississippi buses were segregated, and Mississippi's white people, most of them, were happy with the system just the way it was. Robert Nichols was the city prosecutor for Jackson, Mississippi, the man who enforced Jim Crow laws.
There was an old saying that a black man should stay in his place, and this means that he doesn't particularly interfere with the white man. And I think that was a feeling, undoubtedly, about it.
Mississippi Governor Ross Burnett had assured everybody that the Freedom Riders were a bunch of violent, crazy outsiders and had promised they would not be allowed to ruin things in Mississippi. Bernard Lafayette, a Freedom Rider.
It was a police state in the sense that people did not get out of line. Anything happened in Mississippi, it was ordered. So what we did was disturb this kind of peace and order, which was a negative order, because it was injustice, it was oppression.
Governor Barnett and the city of Jackson vowed to, quote, keep the peace, which meant keeping segregation. Their method? Jail the Freedom Riders. And they had done so. And they continued to do so. Among the riders, a group of students from the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC. They knew the risk. They had been warned. Diane Nash was one of the organizers for SNCC.
The students who boarded the buses were ready to die. Many of them, several of them, gave me sealed letters to be mailed in case they died. And some made out wills. So they made preparations for their deaths before they left.
We didn't have any definite plan, because we really didn't know what was going to happen. We did decide that we were not going to use violent measures such as fire hoses and this sort of thing.
The strategy was to arrest us and then to stop the Freedom Rides.
The student strategy was to pack the jails. The threat of violence was always present.
You could almost feel it in the air. You could see the looks on people's faces. They were standing on the curb and seeing these people parade by. You could hear mutterings of the crowd. If the city had not exercised its duty, there would have been one riot after another in this town. And I mean the serious type where people would be either killed or hurt pretty bad.
Cordell Regan, 16, was one of the youngest jailed in Jackson.
The atmosphere with us was always upbeat. Nobody ever went crazy. Nobody ever said, let me out of here. We sang all the time, and it kept us going. I'll give you a little example of how that goes, okay? Woke up this morning with my mind set on freedom.
When you're scared, sing a song. It helps. The songs also helped recruit local blacks, who by now, in August, were helping to fill the jails. Bernard Lafayette set up an arrest factory. Volunteers would go down to the bus station, call the police, and Captain Ray would take it from there.
And we'd tell them how many people were coming, how many males, females. So just, like a factory, conveyor belt. And we would drive down, and they would walk into the white side of the bus station, and Captain Ray would be there, faithfully, because he'd already been informed.
Patrolman Jim Black was the man who took them to jail.
They came into the area, if the white went into the black area, and was asked to leave by Captain Ray. They did not, then they were arrested. Same way with the blacks, so they went into the white waiting area, and then he would ask them to leave. They did not leave, then he would arrest them.
More than 300 people were jailed that summer. Some were still there on September 22nd, when the Interstate Commerce Commission ruled that segregation on interstate buses and trains was illegal. The old signs came down. A new sign went up. The Freedom Riders had won.
Riding a bus is important. Voting is more important. The movement had begun to change direction in a way that would change everything else. They had taken the next step and begun to try to register black voters in the rural South. And there would be blood on the wall before they were done. Come back to the consequences of the confrontations of that time in 1961. Mel Brooks once put it this way: usually when a lot of men get together, it's called war. In August and September and October of 1961, a lot of men got together without getting to the war part. And a lot of men confronted each other without getting to the peace part. And then, of course, there was baseball. Here's the legacy of what all those men did and did not do.
When the night has come and the land is dark.
The Berlin Wall still stands, patrolled on one side by Allied soldiers who still remain, on the other side by East German border guards. The wall has done its job. The tide of refugees in 1961 has been dammed. Along Bernauerstrasse are memorials to those who died trying to escape. 74 people have been killed since the wall was built. Virtually nobody tries to escape anymore.
Stand by me.
Roger Maris died in 1985. His record of 61 home runs in a season still stands. The closest anyone came was Mickey Mantle, who hit 54 that same year. In 1986, for example, the leading home run hitter was Toronto's Jesse Barfield. He hit 40.
By the time of President Kennedy's death in 1963, there were 16,000 U.S. military advisors in Vietnam. By 1968, there were 500,000 American combat troops there.
No, I won't shed a tear just as long as you stand by me.
The Peace Corps still exists. Since 1961, more than 120,000 Americans have volunteered and served in 94 countries. In 1987, there are 5,500 volunteers in 62 countries.
Stand by me, stand by me.
In 1969, with Sesame Street, children's TV stepped up in class. Now there's even a children's network. One of its programs is a new version of Mr. Wizard.
Enemy attack.
Soon there will be toys that don't just look good on TV, but interact with TV.
You actually participate in the...
You can shoot the bad guys. Kill toy, kill.
The recent freedom marches in Cummings, Georgia, and the Klan activities that spawned them continue to show we don't all stand side by side, black and white together. Not yet. Stand
by me. Stand by me. Well, there it is, the way it was for a season of 1961. Three of those 40 million children under 10 were mine. That summer, I was a night clerk at a primarily residential hotel in New York City, working 6 days a week, taking home $90. Like most of you, I was too busy, too absorbed in family concerns to have been a freedom rider or to have joined the Peace Corps. I regret that. I rejoice that I live in a place that gave me options.
Imagine how our world might look to a truly sane person. Take the Berlin Wall, take the bomb, take the public bathrooms, the ones with signs indicating that Americans, unlike most people, were divided into three sexes, male, female, or colored. On October 27, 1961, Simon & Schuster published a dangerously sane book about our world. It wasn't about the follies of 1961, but it could have been. It's sort of timeless, and it's one of only two books, the other's a dictionary, I consider important enough to own two copies of, a copy for work, a copy for home. Because to define sanity, I need the dictionary, but to keep mine, I need Catch-22. And so it goes. These things also happened during August, September, and October of 1961.
On October 23rd, the late Dag Hammarskjöld was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, the only time it has ever been awarded posthumously.
Former Vice President Richard Nixon announced as a candidate for governor of California.
78 people died in the crash of a TWA plane in Hinsdale, Illinois. It was the worst commercial single plane crash in U.S. history to that time.
CBS, impressed with the coverage of Hurricane Carla by its Houston affiliate, would hire one of the reporters, Dan Rather.
General Walter Beadle Smith, architect Eero Saarinen, Judge Learned Hand, and actress Marion Davies died.
On August 26th, a resolution was introduced into the Senate to award a gold medal to an actor, singer, composer, dancer, and friend to children everywhere. His name was Danny Kaye.
For a transcript